We are honored to be joined here by Admiral Brett Giroir, the Assistant Secretary for Health for the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. Now, we were honored to also have you speak at our Policy Advocacy Institute in February, and at that time you announced many of the administration's policies for the first time. Can you tell us a little bit about what has been accomplished since then?
Well, thank you so much for having me here. That was very fortuitous to be at that forum because the president had just announced our initiative in the State of the Union address to end the HIV epidemic in America. And of course, we're very, very excited about that, with the realistic possibility of reducing HIV infections by 75% within 5 years and by 90% within 10 years. So since that time, we've really jump-started this. We've invested $33 million in our past fiscal year money into communities. We've jump-started initiatives in four communities, including the Cherokee Nation. We have funded all jurisdictions to create ending HIV strategies. Those are due in December. We've visited many jurisdictions. In fact, principals, so myself, Tony Fauci, or Bob Redfield, have visited 40 of the 50 jurisdictions in all seven states to listen to feedback from stakeholders. We've had our President's Advisory Council on HIV/AIDS, no longer just held in D.C., but we had the first one in Jackson, Mississippi, and just one had one in Miami, Florida. So it's been a very exciting time. We're hoping for the appropriation bill to get through so we can invest the next $291 million for fiscal year 2020 into the initiative.
Now, I know you're also passionate about the sickle cell initiative. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Well, thank you so much for asking. I'm a pediatric ICU physician, and I took care of children with sickle cell disease for much of my early career. And I also have personal ties with many families and children with sickle cell disease. So I really took the opportunity as one of my personal initiatives to really try to change the world for the 100,000 individuals in the US who live with sickle cell disease, who still die in their early 40s, but many in their early 30s or 20s. So we've really brought an all of federal government approach to make sure that they're treated with the highest standard of care, and that's just not the case right now. So we're working on quality standards, we're working on education, both for providers and for patients themselves so they could advocate for themselves, and a lot of new initiatives you'll see coming through. One of the recent things we've done is, I learned through my work at the World Health Organization, is that in sub-Saharan Africa, there are 300,000 children born each year with sickle cell disease. Almost none of them are screened, so the mortality rate is up to 80% by age 5 years of age, and that's just unacceptable. So we've really started an international movement with the World Health Organization, the World Bank, USAID, many private organizations. I've been to Africa, been to Congo, really working with all the African delegations, and what I'm very excited about this year is not only will we be working on sickle cell domestically, but we expect a major international effort focused on sub-Saharan Africa, because those 300,000 children do not deserve that fate. It's completely avoidable.
And here in America, one of the big issues is substance abuse. Can you talk to us about where we're at and where we're headed?
Well, I've said before, and I really do agree with this, is that the substance use crisis we have, the overdose epidemic, is the most complex, daunting, and challenging public health issue of our time. I think we all know about 70,000 Americans died of overdoses over the past year. Now, we have really taken a public health approach to this crisis, and that's very important. That focuses on everything we do in the public health community. Number one, prevention, but also very important treatment. And we've emphasized medication-assisted therapy and really made that the stalwart to treat opioid use disorder. We've also supported public health measures that can work on some of the syndemic issues, like syringe services programs, needle exchanges, very, very important. Not only do they prevent HIV and hepatitis C virus, but they have also been proven, evidence-based, to reduce IV drug use and to increase by about 350% the chances of an individual entering recovery. So we're seeing some lights at the end of the tunnel. For the first time in almost three decades, the overdose death rate dropped from 2017 to 2018 by about 5%. But there are about 100 ways that that positive trend could be reversed. And one of them we're really concerned about is the upswing in methamphetamine use in the United States, starting on the West Coast, but now moving eastward. It is an awful drug. It's right now about 100% pure, fueled by international cartels. And we really need to get ahead of that because it could reverse our positive trends.
And APHA has the challenge of creating the healthiest nation in one generation. Can you talk to us about how the administration can help with that goal?
You know, we have a long way to go. As you know, our longevity actually decreased, our life expectancy decreased in 2015, then again in 2017. We rank about 30th on the list of peer high-income countries for life expectancy, about 32nd in infant mortality, 33rd in suicide. So we have a long way to go, and it requires really orthogonal, dramatic changes. And I think probably the most important piece that the administration is supporting, and Secretary Azar holds this as one of his four major initiatives, is value-based transformation. Our healthcare system, and I know it very well as a pediatric ICU doctor, pays people to provide care when people get sick. So actually, the sicker you are, the more people get rewarded for providing that care. We have to completely change that paradigm. Under a value-based system, we want the government and private insurers to pay for health, for outcomes, to pay for preventative care, including social determinants of health. And I think that's really the key to changing our society from a relatively unhealthy society to one that's healthy, because we can't keep continue doing the same things we've done for multiple decades and expect a different outcome. So I think this is the bold transformation that we're under right now. We're starting with Medicare, fee-for-service, very large primary care initiative already announced, at least 11 million people. It will also cover most of the dual eligible, Medicare and Medicaid. And then a number of other initiatives, like our kidney initiative, that will reward physicians and networks for preventing end-stage renal disease or treating it very early, as opposed to waiting to end-stage renal disease and then paying years and years on hemodialysis.
Admiral, thank you so much for taking time out of your busy
day. It's great to be here.
We appreciate all this very valuable information.
Thank you so much for having me. Look forward to working with you again.